Hello. Hi. Yes, perfect. Just some quick ground rules. So for the speakers who have come a little early into the room, hello and welcome, and thank you for being here. I would ask that until it's your turn to speak, that we keep our microphones on mute just to make it easier for everyone. There are a few things that we would like to share first, such as speeches from our management committee, from our executive director, some performances, and then we'll go on to make the section for our guest speakers. So it's wonderful to see you all here, and I can see a number of people coming into the YouTube chat room as well. So welcome to our ladies who are already watching us, and we would love for you to share the link to your friends, to other ladies, anyone all over social media. We'd be happy to celebrate our 10-year anniversary with you all. So without further ado, we'll start the event. Welcome to MEWSo's 10-year anniversary YouTube live event. My name is Rose Fatherazi. I'm the project and service coordinator at MEWSo, and I will be your moderator throughout the whole afternoon, so much so that I am certain you will be sick of seeing my face by the end of this evening. Over the next 3 hours, we will hear speeches from MEWSo's staff, trustees, funders, and guest speakers, as well as testimonies from our clients, and we'll watch some wonderful music performances and art exhibitions. You're welcome to stay as long as you like, or you can return whenever you can. Either way, we will be here until 6 p.m. Afterwards, this event will be uploaded onto our YouTube channel, where it will remain for all to see. Since technology can be unpredictable and I'm manning all quarters for this event, I ask for your patience if we experience any difficulties, delays, or horrible reverbs at any point. It can't be helped. But we'd be grateful if you still share this event. And even afterwards, if you'd like to keep in touch, please visit our website at www.mewso.org and follow us on social media. You should be able to find us if you type at MEWSo on any search engine. Right, well, I'd first like to introduce our founder and executive director, Halaleh Taheri. Halaleh's work and activism has been an inspiration to all of us at MEWSo, and it gives me great pleasure to welcome her onto our virtual stage to share her story with us today. Thank you, Halaleh, over to you.
Thank you very much, Rose. Dear guests, friends, and colleagues, I welcome you all for our virtual anniversary, and I thank you for being with us today. Middle Eastern Women and Society was born in a community where young girls were denied a childhood and forced into adulthood through arranged marriage organized by their parents, where women have slept night after night on a damp pillow, crying for pain, humiliation, and abuse by a perpetrator disguised as a husband. MEWSo was born in a community where young girls were made to feel ashamed about their sexuality and were denied the right due to fears of punishment inflicted by their own families. And as consequences, were made to live in total terror, unable to make sense of their own sexual orientation or gender identity. MEWSo was born in a community where women and girls have been punished, abused, threatened, and killed by their own family in the name of honor, in the name of sharaf, in the name of namus, and in the name of zina, for wanting to live their lives on their own terms. MEWSo was born in a community where women without husbands are pushed and encouraged to enter polygamous relationship, serving a man who rotates his time between multiple wives, while women have been criticized, abandoned, punished, and threatened to death if they have sexual relationship outside the customs rules. MEWSo was born in a community where many young girls are living in between two different cultures. While the young girls in school learn that they have the right to choose their sexual partners, they are faced with a starkly different idea of a traditional marriage by their family's culture, enforced by the barbaric and violating virginity testing procedures that are still legal in this country to this day. The humiliation of a broken hymen is what forces these young girls to walk through welcoming hospital corridors, seeking a way to repair a hymen they have already lost, not necessarily through sex before marriage. MEWSo was born in a community where many women are scared and ashamed to discuss their psychological health, fearing that they will be labeled as mad or crazy in doing so, forcing them to suffer in silence. I founded MEWSo because I myself am from this community. Throughout my own life, I've traveled between 5 countries to find a place to settle when I could rebuild my life. I fought, and I am still fighting for freedom, for equality, for peace, and for a better life. There is no doubt that a better world is possible, a world where women and men are equal, and violence a thing of the past. Our women deserve a better life. That's why we are here. It's often thought that the person experiencing abuse is the person responsible for breaking their silence and standing up against it. But in many cases, and absolutely in our community for hard-to-reach women, it's too dangerous to do so without some intervention and hopefully prevention from third-party service, whose aim is to protect these women and girls. Many of these women are left in dark, unsure about where to go and what needs to be done to end this cycle of abuse in a manner that won't put them in even more danger. In such an environment, women and girls need empowerment tools. They need brave supporters to advocate on behalf of them. And they need a place to protect them from harm. This is where MEWSo comes in, along with many other charities, community experts, service delivered by specialists, and support by local government. But more importantly, it's how we guarantee and that these tools are working, that these resources are continuously in place and will remain to support women and girls. Through defined roles of charities, organizations, and services, implementing existing law and continuing financial support from the government and funders, these tools can be guaranteed. The equality of women and men is a fundamental right that MEWSo upholds. Our aim is to protect women and girls against all harm, cultural customs and beliefs that favor family values and community over the well-being of women and girls. Such customs not only undermine a woman's existence, but also abuses her fundamental rights, forcing women to partake in a role which is profoundly against her best interests. MEWSo will continue to fight against such practice, and since its founding, has decided to be a voice of disadvantaged women and girls within our community, and respectively in wider society, with the goal that we will all be treated with the same value and with the same measure by the law of this country. As the world is struggling to fight COVID-19 and its consequences, I would like to add a few more words. I extend my deepest sympathy with all those people who lost their beloved one. And I thank you, NHS staff and Cllr, for their amazing work. Life after coronavirus looks very uncertain and often time troubling. The pandemic all over the world has pushed society towards more poverty and starvation. As the pandemic has exposed the cracks within the system, which has attacked developers, workers, health and benefit systems, and other frontline service providers, showing society's favoritism of business over regular people, life after COVID-19 could be dangerous for everyone, but most ever for vulnerable people in society, both financially and physically. In the UK, we need to be alarmed and prepared to face similar situation when our welfare and social and health system also is under attack. We have already seen the rise of domestic violence, mental health, discrimination, unemployment, and poverty here at home. MEWSo will continue to fight for and protect our community, making sure to provide for the needs of regular people to the best of our ability. It's important to stand in solidarity with all other groups, communities, and society in whole during such an uncertain time. MEWSo stands with human rights campaigners and environmentalists who are needed now more than ever. More importantly, MEWSo hope that we can all take this time to reevaluate our lifestyles and to start to live happier and healthier lives moving forward as individuals and as a society in order to come back stronger than before. I now take this opportunity to thank all our funders for their generosity and support. Thank you to our various networks and for the experts within our community who have shared their support and resources with us and with our women in need. Thank you to all our wonderful volunteers who dedicated their time for our women when they need them most. Thank you to our board of trustees who believed in me and my team and acknowledge our work and our successes, as well as their wonderful support when we need them. And above of all, thank you to my team, these strong women who are pioneers in our community, who aren't afraid to speak up and be brave in times of injustice, who are resilient in hard times, and who are solid believers in MEWSo's principal aim of rebuilding lives of women. What you see here in this gathering today is the result of this team, volunteers, funders' support, trustees, and beyond. Thank you so much and enjoy the day with us.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Halaleh, for your powerful and inspirational speech. Sorry, I'm juggling both Facebook and YouTube at the moment, so bear with me. Just as I said, it's such a strange time with Corona. Everything is online and everything is, it's such a novel experience, honestly. But thank you so much. For any new speakers who have come into the room, I would please ask that you keep yourself on mute while while we are going through all the other speakers, and then once the guest speakers are ready to when their time allocated time is set, then we'll proceed with that. But thank you so much. Unfortunately, so our chair Cordelia Mayfield was supposed to join us and say a few words, but unfortunately she wasn't able to be here. But she's told me to send her huge congratulations and her best wishes for the event. And now I would like to share some pre-recorded words from our management committee. Without them, MEWSo could not do the amazing work that they've done over the last 10 years, and we're so grateful for their continued support. Here are their experiences being a part of MEWSo.
Happy anniversary to MEWSo. I'm really happy to be here today, celebrating together these 10 years of hard-earned success. Thank you for all the work you do. The impact you have on the society is truly impressive. I'd like to say that I've been proud to be part of your organization for the last 2 years as a trustee and volunteer, and I will be excited to be part of it for many years to come. I wish you, Halaleh, and the entire MEWSo team, who are really dedicated and talented, to continue to success as we are going forward.
Hello everyone, my name is Behnaz Fatherazi and I'm the treasurer for MEWSo. Firstly, I'd like to wish you all a happy 10 years anniversary. And secondly, to congratulate Halaleh, who has dedicated her whole life to MEWSo's cause, and her team for working hard over the last 10 years and making this organization to become what it is today. I would also like to thank MEWSo's volunteers for their selfless contribution to our community. Although I feel that I haven't contributed anything special, but I am still honored and proud to be a part of an organization that helps disadvantaged women in our society. Thank you and wish you all the best and all the success in future. I hope you enjoy the rest of the event.
Hi, I'm Cllr Konaizeh and I've been a board member at MEWSo since August last year. I would like to congratulate MEWSo for its 10th anniversary and for the great work they've been doing in the last 10 years to empower women and to help them rebuild their lives. I'm also quite impressed by the way they've been able to handle the changes brought by this recent pandemic and how they've been able to establish a smoother transition from face-to-face services to online services and still have this amazing impact. I'm very proud to be part of this charity and be part of this amazing team. And I wish everyone involved at MEWSo, Halaleh, the rest of the staff, the volunteers and the service users, all the best and more success to come in the next 10 years. Happy anniversary.
Brilliant. We would now like to share two client testimonies that were pre-recorded, and for personal reasons these clients will have their faces blurred and their names have been withheld in order to remain anonymous.
I was subjected to domestic violence for more than 20 years. I used to feel safer in the streets and around strangers rather than feeling safe at home. One day I was crying to my friend thinking that's it, I was stuck in that position for the rest of my life. She said to me, oh, I know someone who can help. That someone was Zara from MEWSo. In a matter of hours, I started to receive phone calls offering all kinds of help, from housing to counseling and other kind of support. Today, I feel safe in my new home. I actually sleep on a dry pillow rather than the wet one. MEWSo has rebuilt my life. I cannot thank MEWSo or Zara enough for the help they offered me, for the transformation of my life. If you are in an abusive relationship, don't accept it. Reach out for help. Thank you, Zara. Thank you, MEWSo.
Thank you for taking your time to speak with me today.
No, I'm very happy.
I just wanted to ask just a couple minutes to tell me about your experiences with MEWSo. How did MEWSo help you? And how did you find your time working with MEWSo?
Yeah, first I'm happy to see you, Anna. I'm happy to speak with you. Before I'm in difficult situation, very, very difficult situation with I'm homeless with three kids. And when I come to Zahra, she helped me too much. Still now she helped me. And now I'm very happy with my kids. I am in temporary accommodation. And before the council give me somewhere too far, and Zahra, she helped me a lot to bring me in my area, Islington. Before, I am very, very strict. I go to the counselor. Sometimes I don't want life, but now I'm very happy with my kids in temporary, and I'm waiting the counselor give me the permanent. The Zahra helped me for everything, for the English, for now I understand, I speak with the people. Before, I do nothing, just home and stay home. I don't go out, but now I have friends, I learn English. Zahra bring like a teacher, you know, for English for free. The teacher coming to my house to teach me. So I am very, very happy, yeah? I'm very happy for everything.
How long have you been with MEWSo?
2 years.
That's wonderful. We're so happy that we, especially Zahra's work, but we're very happy that we managed to meet you.
I'm very happy to now. Zahra helped me with the council to have permanent. So she done everything for me and for my family and for my kids. So I'm very happy, and I want to tell thank you for everyone, for you, for Halaleh, for Zahra. Everyone helped me, everyone. Halaleh bring the computer for my daughter. You helped me, Zahra, everyone. I want to say thank you so much.
And what do you see for your future? What is something, how do you see your life going now that all these things are working out?
Yeah, I told you before, I'm very, very stressed. Now I am very happy. My life changed, everything changed with my kids, for my kids. Now everything easy for me. You know, if I am homeless, it's not easy when you have kids and you don't have house. Now I am very happy. I am nice house, not too far. Everything near me, the school, everything. So I'm happy. I'm very happy. And thank you so much. Thank you very much.
That's brilliant. Thank you so much for taking time to speak with me today.
No, don't worry. I wish if I did something to return what you do for me. And sorry, my English not very good.
Not at all. It was perfect.
I want to speak more to tell you thank you.
Bless you. I feel like you've improved a lot, though.
Yeah. I go out, we go to the park. I do Zumba with everyone. I have too much friends now. I speak in the Zoom.
Thank you so much, Anna.
No problem. You're welcome.
We'd now like to take a quick break to show you a demonstration of our Monday mindfulness class with our expert facilitator, Gamze Seber, who also facilitates our Zumba and our upcoming storytelling sessions. So we hope you enjoy. After this, we will be going to our speakers. So yes, I hope you enjoy this little break.
Welcome everyone, I'm Gamze Seber and I'm your mindfulness teacher for our class. I teach yoga, mindfulness, meditation and talk about and share about how can we really calm down the mind, be more in the moment to reduce the stress and more living more conscious and gracefully. So let's start the session with just focus on our breath and focus on our heart. And I will play some singing bowls while you're relaxing. So close your eyes and take a deep breath in and out. And then start just natural breathing and observe your breath. Don't want to change anything. Don't push your breath. So let's breathe naturally together. Take a deep breath in again through your nose and breathe out through your mouth. And open your eyes, please. Find a comfortable position, please, for yourself to sit. The spine should be upright, but don't feel that so edgy. So upright, active, but in a way relaxed position. And close your eyes and I will guide you through so you can close your eyes. Take a deep breath in and out. And just observe your breath. Just natural breath. Don't try to make it longer, shorter, or different. Just breathe naturally and observe your breath. And also observe your nostrils, the air around your mouth, your belly, your chest, if it's going in and out, any sensations in your body while you are breathing naturally. And now you can still close your eyes and I'll still keep guiding you. We will breathe in four counts and breathe out in eight counts, so double time. So let's all together breathe in. One, two, three, four, and breathe out. Two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Breathe in, two, three, four. Breathe out, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. In, two, three, four. Out, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. In, two, three, four, out, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, in, two, three, four, out, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, in, two, three, four, out, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, in. Please do it with your own counting for yourself. For a couple of rounds. And keep observing your breath, your chest, your belly area as well. You can open your eyes and you can also observe, is there any difference, little sensational difference, your mind, your heartbeat, generally your body, if you feel any difference. Thank you so much for sharing this session with me. And if you have any questions about the breathing, meditation, or generally you want to share anything or ask anything, you are more than welcome. All the best, and I wish you all have a wonderful week.
Hello.
There we go. Hi. So that was Edeh, for the new speakers who've come in, who might have been wondering what the video was about. It was a demonstration of our mindfulness classes for our wonderful YouTube Live viewers that are watching us right now. And I would now like to thank you for coming in and taking the time to be with us today for our 10-year anniversary. Just a little bit of housekeeping, if we could all keep our microphones muted while others are speaking, just to make things, the transition a bit smoother. And once I call your name, I will introduce you in order of the program. And once I call your name, if you could unmute in preparation, I would greatly appreciate it. So I would first, I should also quickly say, apologies if I mispronounce any names. Coming from a Middle Eastern background, you would think I'd be a bit better and a bit more articulate with names, but unfortunately, sometimes that's not the case. So in advance, I thank you for your patience with me. But I would first like to introduce the Lord Mayor of Westminster, Councillor Jonathan Glanz, who's taken time out of his very busy schedule to be with us today. So we're so thankful for you being here and for the generous financial support, especially that we've received from Westminster Council over the last 4.5 years that we've had based there. So I'm pleased to welcome the Lord Mayor to take the virtual floor and to say a few words. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Rose, and for that kind introduction. Thank you also to Halaleh for inviting me to speak to you today on this great day, the 10th anniversary of the founding of MEWSo. So hello to everybody, and hello to everybody who's watching on Facebook and YouTube. As you probably gathered, I've become the first virtual mayor of Lord Mayor of Westminster. I was appointed at a virtual council meeting, and most of the engagements which I've been involved with have involved Zoom or Teams or podcasts, etc. So it's been a new learning curve for me. But it's obviously a challenging time, and it's a good time, I think, to celebrate as we begin to recover from coronavirus. Thanks to this technology, we can do so in a way which, as I said, I was previously unfamiliar with. But I just wanted to comment on the program today, because I think it's stimulating and thought-provoking. I participated briefly in the breathing exercises earlier, and I can say I feel better for it as a result, so thank you very much for that. But I'd also like to thank Councillor Napsika Butler for that, Thalassis, for asking me to participate today. And thank you, all the speakers and everybody who's participating today, giving up time on their Friday afternoon to be with us and to share your wisdom and talent. It is a real testament, I think, to the work and the reputation of MEWSo throughout those 10 years of your activities that so many wonderful people are here to mark this day together. So that's why I'm particularly glad to join you today as Lord Mayor of Westminster, as First Citizen, as the role gives me a platform to celebrate the achievements of our residents and, like today, the organisations which come together to help and support residents, particularly in times of need. As you will be aware, organisations such as MEWSo have not stopped working during the pandemic. In fact, as their website says, we are still here for you. And the welfare advisors, the domestic abuse advisors, and the telephone advice sessions have continued throughout this period. The work, I think, has changed in unexpected ways as people's lives and habits and experiences have changed due to the restrictions which are in place. But the overall aim of the activity and clearly the need for it remain. Since being founded 10 years ago by the inspirational Halaleh, Taheri, and again, forgive me if I've mispronounced that, this grassroots organization has sought to help disadvantaged women from a number of ethnic, religious, and economic backgrounds, and all over Westminster. And this is particularly true as in Westminster, it has worked for the past 4 years, helping women who face the challenges that come of being part of the global mixing pot that is London in general, and Westminster in particular. Over 70% of the people who live in Westminster were not born in the UK, and clearly within that we have a wide and welcome diversity of people from all over the world. MEWSo has grown faster in Westminster than any other part of London, and has achieved a great deal in the 4 years that it's been operating in our city. I know Westminster City Council has helped to fund the work that it's been doing, but as I said, it has grown particularly helping women from Kurdish, Iranian, Arabic or Afghani communities and help them to access a wide range of services. And now we're seeing an increased number of people coming forward from the Bangladeshi community who have begun to attend your sessions regularly, which is a real example of how wide the support is now being spread. It is really clear that we need services like the befriending volunteers, art therapy, or the support for children in need. And it is very heartening to see how far word has spread of the excellent work that MEWSo has done as the number of people being supported continues to rise. This all means that more women and young girls have been assisted by emotional support advisors who have also tackled ongoing welfare and domestic violence issues. An unfortunate side effect of the coronavirus pandemic is a rise in domestic violence and abuse, making it more important that we have organisations working within our communities to help tackle these issues. I know MEWSo's advisors and staff are working hard to manage many cases during the pandemic, as this type of abuse, as I said, has sadly increased. There's also been the need to support more women who have had to tackle the isolated atmosphere around them, which has been exacerbated by these restrictions, I think particularly for older women who perhaps find it more difficult to communicate with their neighbours, that help has been particularly welcome. Like any sensitive community work, MEWSo's advisors build bridges between them and the women whom they help and use this trust to help them speak out about their worries. As a result, it can certainly be said that MEWSo is now one of the most trusted organisations for networking and partnership with other charities here in Westminster. Your successes have helped many women become empowered and feel safe in their own homes and communities. Younger women have started work experience programmes, undertaken volunteering opportunities, or are thinking about further education. Many isolated women are engaging with healthy activities in their area and more often than they had before. And this is a fantastic achievement. So once again, I would like to thank all of you for your outstanding work, both over the past 10 years and particularly now as the coronavirus continues to affect us in our day-to-day lives. You have really helped change Westminster and significantly change it for the better. And I'm very happy to be here with you today. Here's to the next 10 years. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lord Mayor, for your very kind words. Next, I would like to introduce Professor Elena Vacchelli from Greenwich University, who has worked with us on our Polygamy Matters campaign almost 2 years ago now. So thank you very much for coming, Professor Vacchelli, and I'm looking forward to hearing your words for today.
Thank you so much. I wanted to just check that you hear me okay, because I'm connecting from a Wetherspoon on the Isle of Wight, where I came So, exactly. So hopefully you can, the background noise is not too bad. I'd like to actually talk about my relationship with MEWSo that starts before actually the polygamy project itself. So when I first approached MEWSo, I was working at the Social Policy Research Center at Middlesex University. And I contacted Halaleh to interview her for a project that we were doing on access to mental health support for migrant women. And it's funny because initially Halaleh was a bit not very happy to be talking to researcher, very skeptical. But then when we had this interview, we connected at a very personal level. And I felt immediately very inspired by the work of MEWSo, to the point that her interview was, and the example of what MEWSo does for Middle Eastern women was used in a paper that I wrote for an academic journal called City. And the argument I made there was really based on the interview I had with Halaleh, that integration is not just this jump from isolation to integration to the British society as such, but what Halaleh said that she was trying to do with the women that she works with is more achieving integration step by step. And that is more important to create practices of solidarity and create small groups in the neighborhood at a local level, rather than expecting that a person from a situation of isolation can suddenly and miraculously feel integrated in the society, in the British society as a whole. So I found this argument very inspiring, because this is what basically MEWSo is doing with such passion and inspiration. So really, after this, we stayed in touch. In the meanwhile, I changed university, so I started working at Greenwich University. And one of the first things that I did when I joined Greenwich University was securing some internal fundings to carry on a project on polygamy and polygamous practices, something that I was interested in. And once again, my personal interest converged with Halaleh's and MEWSo's interest. So we ran several workshops in different locations. So one in Westminster, one in Finsbury Park, one in Ashway, where we really used and experimented digital storytelling as a medium, and where women with great generosity shared their personal story of polygamy that at times can be also very painful. During these workshops, what emerged really strongly is that really confirms what other studies have said on families in polygamous situations, which is that women very often, especially first wives, are in very difficult position and really experience emotional pain. So when the husband, especially without negotiating the polygamous circumstance with them, goes ahead and marries somebody else. So this is a really deeply traumatic experience for the women themselves and also for their children. But very often, there are pressures from the family to accept polygamous relationship, because there is a huge stigma around divorce. So women are put in the situation where they rather accept this less than ideal scenario rather than, divorce. At times, even for second wives can be difficult, because at times second wives are not even told that they are the second wife. And in one situation, a second wife who was rejected, actually she discovered that the previous husband had another family and she didn't know she was really hurt, and that meant that then the relationship broke, and she ended up without children, and she was really, you know, in a really difficult situation because of that. There was also a discussion about intergenerational issues, because some of the participants agreed that polygamy perhaps can work in situations where the lifestyle is different, in more rural situations, in previous generations, and that nowadays is very difficult at a time in the West, and then at a time where the mononuclear family is the model. So we have, if you're interested in reading more about this, we have a report that I think is still accessible from the MEWSo website. So you can see there even the pictures of the workshop, the amazing methods that, and creative and participatory methods that we use to get to these findings, including body mapping, storytelling, and other approaches that included in also in a couple of occasions making videos with the women. And there is also a quite large literature review on the issue of polygamy as well, if you're interested in reading that. So, well, in conclusion, I'd like to really wish MEWSo a happy anniversary, and that the organization can continue to inspire, create practices of solidarity, and help women in difficult situations, and that we can keep working together in future. So thank you for your attention, and thank you, Halaleh, for inviting me.
Thank you so much, Elena, for speaking. And even in the Wetherspoons, it was wonderful. Thank you. And yes, Professor Vacchelli is right. You can find the report on MEWSo's website. It's underneath our Polygamy Matters campaign, and you can see all the pictures and learn more if you'd like to. Next, I'd like to introduce Arinola Edeh from Westminster Adult Education Services, who has funded our mindfulness and wellbeing classes, as you saw a small demonstration of it earlier. And this has been going on for the last 2 years. And we, so yes, please, Arinola, thank you so much for coming today. I know you're incredibly busy, and I pass it over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Rose, for that introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. As Rose said, I'm the principal and head of service for Westminster Adult Education Service, based in Lisson Grove, very local to where MEWSo does a lot of the great work that they do. First and foremost, I'd like to, you know, congratulate MEWSo on their 10-year anniversary. It's actually such a fantastic achievement when you think about, you know, the starting point in terms of what Halaleh actually set out to achieve. So thank you so much, Halaleh, for inviting me to actually be a part of your 10-year anniversary celebration this afternoon. For us at Westminster Adult Education Service, also fondly known as WAES, it's really all about partnership, and working with organisations like MEWSo is in our DNA. As Rose alluded to, we have supported and funded the Me and My Mind project, which has had tremendous benefits for women locally in Westminster, and it is really, really helping them to rebuild their lives. We've been working with MEWSo now for just under 3 years in Westminster, and I'm pleased to say that the work that you do in supporting women, in building their confidence, their self-esteem, promoting their health and well-being, is phenomenal. It's absolutely phenomenal. I came to one of your events recently, and just listening to the women talk about what their journeys have been and how they have progressed, some of them, you know, not being able to even articulate or say a word in those first initial meetings. But actually, when I came to that event, they were presenting their stories, and that they couldn't have done without, you know, the support that they've had from you. We've seen the results of the work that you do, and MEWSo is now a well-established, well-respected and trusted, because that's the thing, it's about the trust. And actually, sometimes as large organizations, it's really difficult for us to actually build that trust with the local community because we're not close enough to it. And so it takes organizations like MEWSo to actually reach the parts that we can't and reach some of those people that we can't. A lot of the time, sometimes we talk about how to reach. Actually, I'd flip it on its head. It's not about, you know, people or communities or women being hard to reach. Sometimes as services, we're hard to access because of the way that we're actually set up. But I think that's what sets MEWSo apart in terms of it being an organization that's quite open. You know, they've got their faces there that people recognize and trust, and they're prepared to actually walk over the threshold and actually have those real deep conversations with the MEWSo workers to actually help them and support them on what that next journey is. And some of the work that you've been doing in terms of supporting women who are maybe perhaps fleeing domestic violence, who've been marginalized due to their social and economic circumstances. Again, you know, we've seen the outcomes from that. And what's really great about our partnership is what we do see is a progression of some of those women onto our more substantial programs in the college so that they can actually start to really rebuild their lives and shape a future for themselves and their families. So it's a valuable partnership for us, and we really and truly want to continue it. And 10 years, well, I think, given the situation that we're in now, we know that organizations like MEWSo definitely need to be around for a lot longer than the next 10 years. Because what, if anything, this virus has taught us that our local community organizations are much better at sort of being much more agile and responsive to the needs of our local community than we are. And when I actually look at what has been achieved by organizations like MEWSo in this crisis, I just take my hat off to each and every one of you. You've worked tirelessly throughout this, you know, situation. You haven't actually let any of the challenges phase you, but what you have done is take those people with you and ensure that those who would have been, you know, isolated, excluded, you know, due to their circumstances, you have found ways to actually reach them and keep in contact with them so that they don't feel isolated through this process. So we, you know, and I'm saying from my colleagues, we really hope that we will continue this partnership. And we, you know, hope that you as an organization will continue to grow from strength to strength, because we will need organizations like yours to actually get us out of this crisis and actually help with the recovery and the renewal of our communities. There's a lot of work ahead of us, Halaleh and colleagues, and I'm hoping that, you know, we can actually start to shape some of that as we actually start to move forward into the future. So thank you once again for inviting me, you know, to your event. Wish you all the best, you know, for the future. And as I said, hopefully it's a shared future where we can have a shared vision for how we can continue to support those who need our help. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your kind and passionate words. And I can definitely say on behalf of MEWSo that we treasure our partnership with WACE, and we're very much looking forward to working with you, continuing to work with you in the years to come. So thank you. And to close off our first round of speakers, I would like to introduce Natasha Feroze, who is a MA student in broadcast journalism at City University. And Natasha has actually interviewed Halaleh for her final project centered around hymenoplasty, since we have an active campaign on this. And we're thrilled to be able to show, hopefully, a short clip of the documentary in question. So I will hand it over to Natasha, who will take it away. Thank you, Natasha.
Thank you so much, Rose. Yes, congratulations on your 10-year anniversary. It's absolutely fantastic. And I'm just so flattered to be here. This is the first documentary I've ever produced. And to do it on hymenoplasty is just such an important topic, especially in the UK. It's something that nobody really seems to know about. And yet it's a growing industry, as well as virginity testing as well. It's been a really shocking experience and so moving to be able to speak to Halaleh and also some of the women as well. I've been able to see some of the videos of MEWSo in action, which has been really fantastic. It's a 15-minute documentary, but I've only got about 5 minutes to show you. But hopefully it will be published and you'll be able to hear more about it. But the only thing I do really want to say before I show you the documentary is just please, you know, keep telling me your stories and keep in touch, because I really care about women's rights and I really want to make a difference. And if you share your stories with me, I hopefully can have a platform where I can share them with everyone else. So I really look forward to a long relationship with MEWSo, and I hope so. So I'm just going to try and share my screen. See how this works. Share. This could go wrong. I have someone to help me. My housemate, sorry. You share, because this is.
You're sharing the screen now.
Yeah. So it's here. Here it is.
Okay, so you're not sharing anymore.
Share.
Yeah.
Can you see it?
Minimize this. Minimize this.
I can see it.
You can you see the Zoom thing as well? There we go. Here we go.
Britain's virginity industry
is a disgraceful, disgusting, horrific thing to do because it means that women are not equals.
We have yearly trips to the gynecologist to check her height.
How much is your virginity worth?
That's anxiety and kill those young girls.
Culture can have a damaging effect on me. But it saved my life, that's for sure.
The government is investigating hymen repair surgery, and we will take all necessary action to ensure that all vulnerable women and girls are protected.
In some communities in Britain today, traditions are still a powerful force. Young girls are brought up being taught that their virginity is a symbol of their purity and virtue. Unlike men, girls that lose their virginity prior to marriage or without their family's consent can be shamed in the community.
Preserving the honour of that family. So a woman's virginity is one of those things.
In desperation, women are resorting to a surgery that promises to give them back their virginity by stitching up their hymen. It's called hymen repair surgery or hymenoplasty. And requests for this procedure have quadrupled in the last 6 years.
I was so alone. I didn't know anyone who could support me. No one in my family knew about how far I went in my relationship with my ex-boyfriend. Then I remembered that when I was at uni, girls would talk about a special kind of surgery. I was terrified, but I didn't have a choice.
Driving the virginity industry are two damaging myths about the hymen, which is a thin membrane of connected tissue at the entrance to the vagina. The first myth claims that in order for a woman to be a virgin, she must have an intact hymen. Some doctors offer virginity tests and claim that they can tell a woman's sexual history by examining her hymen. In the 1970s, these degrading and invasive examinations were done to Asian women entering the UK.
They started examining women to see whether they were virgins or not, on the grounds that no Indian man sending a woman would accept someone who wasn't a virgin as his potential wife.
The hymen comes in many different shapes and can change over a woman's lifetime.
Sometimes we come across virgins who have really petulous hymen, and sometimes we come across people who have had sexual intercourse and the hymen is still very tight.
50 years ago, doctors in America examined the hymen of 36 pregnant teenagers. They discovered that 34 of these women still had an intact hymen. The second myth is that when a woman loses her virginity, her hymen should break, causing her to bleed. Some women are even expected to show bloodstains on bedsheets after the first night of marriage as proof of virginity. These tests lead people to believe that the hymen is like a layer of skin covering the entrance to the vagina. And when a woman loses her virginity, the hymen is always broken. But the hymen doesn't necessarily break. It looks more like this. So in sexual intercourse, the hymen is just stretched. Now, this can cause it to tear, which can cause some bleeding, but it only happens to about 50% of women. The Middle Eastern Women's Society is a support group based in London who recently set up the Hymenoplasty Matters campaign.
we are right in the heart of the community. We can encourage, empower women and the community, the rest of the community, that this is a hymen is just a mist, and then value of a woman, of a proper person to starting a life is not just connected with the hymen. It's not connected at all with hymen.
Another part of MEWSo's campaign is to ban virginity testing.
Virginity test is against human rights, against women's rights, and it should be banned. And by the law, even from UN, United Nations, it's banned.
So how can you tell if a woman's a virgin or not? The truth is, you can't.
What is virginity? I really dislike this phrase.
Because of the persistent and damaging ideas associated with virginity, some have decided it's time to move on, adopting a new phrase,
sexual debut.
Sexual debut.
The thinking behind sexual debut is that you don't lose anything. Nothing is taken from you. Instead, you share an intimate experience with someone. I asked Halaleh Taheri how she thinks we can move forward.
Ban is good, but it's not enough. Education is really, really important. These people in the community must be educated. The social movement just started. We are all in, and we hope that in solidarity with each other, we can do more.
There we go. I hope you enjoyed that. And yeah, please do stay in touch. I'll go over back to you, Rose. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. For a second, I completely forgot where I was. I was just really interested in watching and then thought, oh no, I'm on a call. Thank you so much for sharing. And I'm so excited to see the full product when it's out. And if, of course, we will definitely keep in touch. We loved working with you on this. So thank you. So I'll take this time to say thank you to all our wonderful speakers who came and took their time and shared their words and their experiences with us. We hope that it was just as interesting for you as it was for us, and we hope to see you over on YouTube after Halaleh also says her thank you.
Yeah, actually I'm very, very touched. Thank you so much. And it's amazing to having all of you. It's amazing that MEWSo can survive, women can survive while we all are together, while we all are helping. For each of you, I don't know how to thank you that you came and you added so much to MEWSo's success and happiness for another 10 years as well. Thank you, we need you all again, especially for our campaign. Elena, Natasha, you are on, and the other friend who are coming later. Our dearest funders, we really need you because women always need us, so we need you too. And it's really important. If you wanted to change the attitude in the communities, that's a part of the work that we are doing that. It's a long way, I know, but it works and it works. Thank you so much again.
Thank you to everyone. And on behalf of MEWSo, we wish you a wonderful afternoon ahead, and we hope to see you over on YouTube Live for the rest of the event. Thank you so much. Thank you. So for our YouTube Live viewers, welcome back. For the time being, we're going to take a short break and bring you some entertainment. I'd like to introduce our welfare advisor, Sodabeh Gashtasebi, who is not only our welfare advisor, but also an incredibly talented artist. So she'll go through her exhibition with you today, as well as music from the wonderfully talented Wild. So as soon as I share my screen, that will be there for you to see as well. Thank you.
Sodabeh Gashtasebi, I am welfare advisor in MEWSo, and I run numbers of different workshops such as art and craft for children and women. as I am artist myself, and later on I will show you some of my artworks. I provide information, advice, and access to the welfare benefit system for women from different backgrounds. A lot of the women I help suffer from depression, loneliness, physical and psychological abuse, English language barrier, etc. They make a lot of progress through other services we provide. I'm running some workshops, include cooking, gardening, health, and art. Currently, other workshops are held online, whereas previously, before the virus pandemic, these workshops were held in a large room. I am also run LGBT project for Middle East clients who need these facilities where they have been suppressed in their countries of origin. Middle Eastern Women's Society and organization is happy to include and help many more women. And now, on to my art exhibition. Thank you. My artwork is based around color, shape, forms. And I'm showing you some of my artworks, which are acrylic based, and the collage and sculptures. Okay. We can start with the acrylic paint. This one is first one. As you see, blue color dominated, and that's why acrylic, yeah, and brush. And this one too, this one is abstract too, and the same as that one, with brush and acrylic. And this one is fluid painting. And you can hang it, hang on the wall, horizontal or vertical, it's up to you. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this one, my favorite one, this one is by palette knife. And as you see, I use different colors. Yeah. Okay. Yep. This one is another one. Same as others, acrylic base. And this one, please don't ask me what it is. Yeah, it's up to you. What do you get from my paintings? Okay, and this one, orange red painting, and acrylic. Most of the time I'm using acrylic. Acrylic is much easier for me. And my small one, this one is paint and sand. Lot of sand. I don't know, it's half a kilo sand I used on it, just as a texture. Yeah. Okay, shape and line. I use primary colors, mostly. Yeah. They are twin. Yeah, just I use a line and tape. This one is fluid one, fluid painting, liquid painting. And I pour a paint on canvas, on the canvas, and I'm shaking. And as I said, it's up to you what you see, and Christmas tree or some trees, forest. Okay, and watercolor, I usually don't do that, but this is, yeah, I can. Yeah, this is watercolor. Yeah. And this is another one with a different shape. Watercolor. Okay. Okay, I'm going to show you my collage first. Okay, this is collage. Here is collage made for made from paper and glue, PVA glue. This one is made by some small papers. Actually, 8-9 pieces of paper. Yeah. And this one too. Yep. Yeah. This one is made by some papers. It looks one piece, but it's not. Yeah, that's about exploitation in Africa. And abstract one. Yeah, this is a paper, as you see, small newspaper, a piece of a book, actually old book is here, and I use a different color. Yeah. And another favorite one, this one. And this one is, as I said, made by some pieces of paper, small pieces of paper, actually 10-12 pieces are matched together. Actually, this is handmade. I didn't do Photoshop. Actually, I don't know Photoshop. I don't know how to use it. Just handmade. I did. Okay. We are going to sculptures. I'm going to show you three figures, three Iranian heads. This is Nima Yoshish. Nima Yoshish is Iranian poet. And we call him father of classic poem, Nima Yoshish. Yeah. I sculpted by clay, and then I made a mold on it. Mold is by silicone rubber. Another one is Ahmad Shamlu. Ahmad Shamlu is exactly the same process. Ahmad Shamlu is a writer, Iranian writer. A poet. And yeah, unfortunately he died 6-7 years ago, I believe, maybe more. And then Farooq Farrokhzad. Farooq Farrokhzad is Iranian poet. Yeah. All made by plaster. That's a plaster. And actually, I painted white. Okay, my sculptures are international. This one is Charles Darwin. My Charles Darwin sells in National History Museum. Yeah. Charles Darwin. And Einstein, Albert Einstein. Yeah. This is also plaster, and very heavy. Yeah, this sculpture is William Morris, British artist, British socialist artist. Unfortunately, a lot of people don't know William Morris in UK. And William Morris' art was about textiles, and textiles, fabric. And we have William Morris Gallery in London, Walthamstow Gallery or Museum. Yeah. Okay, another one is socialist Polish women, Rosa Luxemburg. Yeah, anti-war activist and economist, Rosa Luxemburg. Okay, next one. I don't need to explain about Karl Marx. Everybody knows Karl Marx. Yeah, regardless you believe it or not, you like it or not, you know anyway, you know him. And Charles Dickens. Everybody knows Charles Dickens by Oliver Twist. Everywhere, all countries, not just in UK. And by Oliver Twist books, by Oliver Twist films, yeah. Charles Dickens. Okay, and yeah, I think I finished, and I hope you found my artwork interesting. Thank you.
Salam, I'm Wild. I'm a singer-songwriter based in London. And thank you to Sodabeh for inviting me to play for you at the 10th anniversary celebration of the Middle Eastern Women and Society Organization. Very happy to be here. And yeah, I've got a couple of country folk songs. This first one is called Sun in My Heart. And feel free to sing along with the chorus if you'd like to. Well, I was alone and I was down. I went through life with a big old frown, and then one day you came my way, made my life sunny and chased the clouds away. And if you should ever get to leaving, well, I am just one thing of you. I can keep a little of your sun in my heart, so my skies will always be blue. Mm-hmm. Well, the spring is pretty with the flowers all in blue, and the long summer days are lovely too. And in the cold of fall and winter, well, I know I'll be keeping warm with you. And if you should ever get to leaving, well, I am just one thing of you, that I can keep a little of your sun in my heart, so my skies will always be blue.
That's the last chorus.
And if you should ever get to leaving, well, I ask just one thing of you, that I can keep a little of your sun in my heart, so my skies will always be blue. May I keep a little of your sun in my heart, so my skies will always And I've got another song from the woods. This is called Old Home of Mine. And it's from a few years back. I spent a long time sort of wandering in the woods and the forest, and found a lot of healing and peace there. I actually identify as non-binary and trans, and for me, nature was really an important part of that process, and finding that peace in nature was very helpful at that time. So yeah, this is Old Home of Mine. Well, I'll go to the woods in the morrow, 'cause I didn't make time for that today. And I'm away from there too long, there's a sorrow in my heart, I lose my way. Go back to that old home of mine, to the wilds that have been changed with time, where I leave all my troubles behind, and the kind earth heals my soul. And the trees, they hear my call, help me let the worries go and point me towards home. Well, in each and every part here I see myself, from the meadows and the blossom and the woods. You taught me there's a time for everything in life, not to run ahead of seasons in my thoughts over. Go back to that old home of mine, to the wilds that haven't changed with time, where I leave all my troubles behind, and the kind earth heals my soul. And the trees, they hear my call, help me let the worries go and wind me towards home. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so I break the world again, knowing that the world is my friend. If I am lost, look to the stars. If I am lost, look to the land. Go back to that old home of mine, to the worlds that haven't changed with time, where I leave all my troubles behind, and the kind earth heals my soul. And the trees, they hear my call, help me let the worries go and point me towards home. Carry my heart home. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of the show.
Brilliant. Oh, reverb once again. I love their voice. Wild is such, it sits so well in my heart. Thank you and welcome back to our YouTube Live viewers who are watching us. So now on to the second half of our speakers for today. I would like to say thank you to for them for being in the room with us right now. Just again, some housekeeping rules. it's for all of us to keep our microphones on mute when someone's talking, just so that it's easier to manage. And when I call your names, if you could please unmute in preparation, that would be wonderful. I would first like to introduce Shadi Amin, who is an LBTQ plus campaigner and who is working with us on our new LBTQ plus project starting this month. So Shadi, please take it away.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you, Rose. Thank you. Thank you, MEWSo, for the invitation. And I agreed. Do you have my voice? Do you hear me? Do you hear me?
Yes, I hear you now.
Okay, perfect. So thank you very much. And I would like to congratulate the MEWSo for the 10th anniversary. And I wish you all the best for the next 100 years. And I hope that we don't need you anymore, that the women have not such problems, they are not under such violence relations, that they need such organization. Unfortunately, we need you now. As Halaleh said, we need you because the women, the victims of this system needs you. So I told Sodabeh, as she invited me for talking to you here, to speak in Farsi. I'm based in Germany. My second language is German, and I try to talk in English because I didn't know that it's not a mix or bilingual event. So I will try to do my best to explain the situation of LGBTI people in Iran and what we did as a Six Sang. I try to introduce myself in a short sentences that you know who I am and what we do. I am, as you mentioned, Shadi Amin. I am founder and executive director of Six Rank, which is the Iranian Lesbian and Transgender Network. And we focus on our work on changing the situation in Iran when it comes to the situation of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and trans persons. But we focus on women. It means we are the only and the first organization who is focused on the situation of women. It means trans women. It means lesbians. And for us was really important to work on an issue which is forgotten from a lot of organizations who worked or tried to work on the LGBTI issues. So the Six Rank is working on international level. However, our main work is focused on the situation in Iran. We have a counseling center. We do a lot of counseling sessions. We have psychologists who are working with us, and we have every day, I know that it's unbelievable, but we have about 20 to 30 persons every day that we they are approaching us. They need counseling. They are in Iran, and we do that because we And through our research about the life of LGBTI people in Iran, which we did in 5 years ago, and it was a 3 years ongoing research interviewing more than 110 persons in Iran, we found out that one of the problems and challenges we have in Iran is lack of information about the sexual orientation and gender identity. And the second one is the lack of helping and supporting centers for the people who are in need. So, and the psychologists, most of them, they have a homophobic approach. And that's why we built this counseling center. And from that time, we do this work on a daily basis. And we are really happy to be able to help these persons, and the average of the age of the persons who approach us is from 13, 12 years old till maximum 35, and sometimes older. But it shows us that the new generation is more faced for these issues. They have more questions about their sexual orientation. They don't accept the heteronormative issues and norms easily. And I want to ask organizations who are working on the women issues like you to be more inclusive. As the question today is, who is a woman? We see that in a lot of cases, the definition of women is a biological cisgender woman. And we see that the lesbian and transgender women, they don't know where to go, even if, for example, by your organization, they will be welcome, but they don't see this inclusivity in the name, in the approach of the organization when it comes to public relations. And I hope that we will see that more than the people who come as migrant, as refugees to countries like UK, they can come easily to organizations who work on women issues and not only trying to find an LGBTI organization to help and support them. Because as we know, all of us, that the LGBTI organization, they have not enough resources to help all of the people who need it. And a lot of lesbian women, they don't want to go there because they are afraid to be known from their families. And for them is easier to come to so-called normal women organization and to ask for help. And as you know, in Iran is having a same-sex sexual conduct is punishable from flogging to death penalty. And it is for men and women, for both, but for the women is for the fourth time punishable by the death. And we as Sixth Rank, we tried to bring this issue to UPR, to other international human rights bodies, such UN mechanism and special reporters. So with writing reports and about the situation, giving submissions about the situation of LGBT youth in Iran, LGBT children, LGBT people with disability. And we tried to connect all these issues together and to find out what is the intersectionality between this violence that we are facing with. What is it when a woman from a poor family comes and is faced with this violence? What is the difference between this woman with a person who has disability and is challenging with that issue too? So all these issues, we try to bring it in the community to discuss about that in our social media, in our website, and other productions we have, like videos or other media. So, and I think that we did a great work, but we are never happy and satisfied. We want always more and more. We have a lot of issues to change in this society. So, but we had with our work, with our book, which name is Gender X, we had a lot of success because the world could hear us somehow. When you see the Home Office report from UK, you see that from 2014 till now, always when they come to LGBTI situation in Iran, they use our reports. And it means we are trusted by governments, by NGOs, by the victims. And I hope that we can continue our work and to be connected with other organizations who work in the same direction. So the other issue which I want to mention shortly is the refugees who are in Turkey and in England. I think all of us, we are challenging a lot of political issues too. It means when we help a victim to try to rebuild her life, it's not easy to do that always. It's not only an individual case. It is a case like a lot of other cases that we don't know about them. We didn't hear about them. And this is the responsibility of the politicians about the, from the parties, from the local authorities to find out what is going on in every household. So in, and they don't do that. This is what I think we have to talk about that more and more, that they know that they are responsible. It's not only responsibility of the organization like MEWSo to do that. This is the responsibility of them to do that in a bigger picture. And as I said, for me, is as Six Sang for us is really important to see more organizations that are more inclusive when it comes to LGBTI people. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to talk to you. خیلی ممنون از همتون. الان مجبورم این چند جمله رو به فارسی بگم. مرسی حلاله جان. سخنرانی اولتون شنیدم. من وقت نداشتم ولی فکر کردم که هم ادب اجازه نمیده هم علاقه خودم که از اول جلسه نباشم. و خیلی ممنون ازتون. ما we are Six Sang is based in London. We have our office in Archway, which is now closed. I am now in Berlin, and we will be back in August, I hope. But we are operating from all over the world. We have our colleagues in Australia, in Canada, in Germany, in Iran, in Turkey, and I hope that we see each other soon in London, maybe in another event in face to face. Thank you very much. Merci as Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Shadi. I mean, Halaleh, did you want to?
Yes. Actually, Shadi, I'm always one of the admirer of your work. I know you very well, and I follow everything you are doing, you and your colleague and all the team at your organization. And just because this year we started this campaign and this work in within the North African and Middle Eastern communities in London, I would be honored that we will be part of any project, any work that we are doing. We are ready for that. We have capacity, we have passion, we have interest, and definitely person like you and your team, it will be the best partner in future that we will work together. As you said exactly, it's not about a few households that we are individually working with them. It's a big change. It's a big change in the community, in the society, and it's not just MEWSo's responsibility, your organization's responsibility. It's the government's responsibility. It's the authority's responsibility. And all is related to the changing law, to be connected and continuing follow up with even the changing law, we still must observe if it's working or not. It looks like that we are in the same boat. Thank you so much for your time. You were here with
thank
us.
You. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shadi. Next, I'd like to invite Nafsika Thalassis from a BME Health Forum to speak. I've not been at MEWSo for very long, but it's been a pleasure to work with Nafsika in our Church Street network. Thank you for joining us.
Hi.
Thank you very much for inviting me. And I have really enjoyed myself so far. It's been so great listening to all the speeches and the viewing the art and the music, and it's been very, very interesting. Now, I know I have only known MEWSo for a few years, nowhere near as many as you've been around for 10 years, and we're neighbours. We work in the same office. And when you work in the same office as someone, you get to know them really well, and you see what they're like, what people are like with clients, how staff treat each other. And obviously MEWSo is a very, very impressive organisation, and they're a delight to work with. I mostly know Halaleh, Sodabeh and Rose, and they're all, you know, such excellent workers, and you can see when they support each other and they support clients, they're so caring and non-judgmental towards their clients, but also so empowering towards their clients, which is what matters more than anything. And the work makes such a difference to the community. And we have worked together in a few small projects, and it's a delight working with MEWSo because they are such a competent and professional organization and do such a really good job. And it's been amazing watching MEWSo, see how you worked during the pandemic, and how much you've adapted so quickly to change your work and support your users. And that has obviously made a massive difference to people. And, you know, I think we're all working for a better future. We're hoping for a better future. And it's organizations like MEWSo that will make that happen. So I'm honored to work with you and to be your partner. And it's an absolute pleasure to see you flourish and see what excellent work you do for the community. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much for your kind words. Thank you, and for taking the time to be with us and to watch the event with us today. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
Finally, I'm delighted to introduce Elizabeth Jimenez-Yanis from Step Up Migrant Women. We've been involved with their campaign to protect migrant women from domestic abuse for about 2 years, I believe. And I'm very delighted to meet you and virtually meet you, Elizabeth. And so thank you so much for joining us and for taking time to speak today.
No, thank you very much for the invitation. It's very nice to be here. I'm really, really honored to be part of the 10th anniversary celebration of MEWSo, and particularly during these these times where community-based organizations are, the work that we are doing is so vital for the women we support. So just to give you a little bit of context, I'm the policy and communication coordinator on violence against women and girls at the Latin American Women's Rights Service. LORS is a by and for feminist and human rights organization supporting the immediate and the strategic needs of Latin American women living in the UK. I think Halaleh mentioned very well at the beginning of the event, we are living unprecedented times, and this pandemic has exacerbated the structural inequalities that we were working before the pandemic with. We are aware of the surge of domestic abuse as a result of social distancing and the lockdown. And it's during these times and due to the lack of a coordinated emergency response from the government that the role of organizations like ours is so important, because we are supporting women and girls who otherwise would be left behind, right? And I know the important role that organizations like MEWSo are making a huge difference in the life of migrant and BME women living in the UK. And for that reason, I feel that it's very important to celebrate your existence and the invaluable work that you do supporting women and girls, is particularly the most vulnerable of them, right? I think an important part of what I wanted to say today is to recognize the amazing work and success that you did moving your face-to-face services to remote provision? Because I know it's difficult. We are also a small organization, and it was like a huge challenge to do that, right? And I remember when, like a couple of weeks after the lockdown started, I talked to Hal, and it was a great talk because we had the opportunity to share what were the challenges of moving the service provision, but I was so happy to hear how well you did. And it was amazing to hear that you were not only addressing the most emergency needs of women, but also looking to improve mental health. And she told me about the storytelling project that you have, the Zumba classes. I heard about the mindfulness sessions. And to be honest, after the demonstration just a little bit ago, I might join you next because it's so good. Like it was so good. And I'm so glad women in our communities have the opportunity to have the doors of organizations like MEWSo open, like even in a digital format. So I'm very happy. So just, I think I'm here also to speak about the campaign, that it's been great. I've been in coordinating the campaign for less than a year, but since the beginning, I started to try to contact the organizations who are partners. So for people who don't know about the campaign, we are the Step Up Migrant Women campaign is a coalition of more than 50 organizations from different sectors, migrant sector, women's sector, social justice sector. And we advocate and work for the rights of migrant and BME women living in the UK. In the last months, we have been working very hard in trying to influence the domestic abuse bill. As many of you know, the bill doesn't have any protection for migrant women. And we are working like very hard for this to change. Sadly, on Monday, the bill passed through the House of Commons without any modification in terms of provisions for migrant women. But we are not giving up, and there's like the next stages of the bill, and we will continue to work. And I'm very happy to know that MEWSo is part of the coalition. I'm really glad. And yes, Hal, we're gonna make it. So we won't give up. It doesn't matter. We know we are dealing with a hostile environment and a hostile government, but we are here, and together we are gonna make it. So I'm very happy to know that. So just to finish, I really want to congratulate everyone, the team, the volunteers, and Hal for your great commitment, advocating for the rights of women and girls. Thank you for the amazing work you do challenging systematic discrimination and racism. Thank you for the work you do educating communities, because that's so important in the work we do. And thank you. Thank you for your active like campaigning. So all the different campaigns you are part of are so important, and I think they make a huge difference in the communities we work with, and that's the most important part. So just to finish, happy 10th anniversary, and thank you very much for having me here. I'm very, very glad to be here.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth, for your warm and kind words. And yes, you're right, the fight goes on, and when we won't give up, no matter how much hostility we're met with down this road, it's an incredibly important campaign. So thank you very much. And thank you to all our speakers who spoke today and who took time to share their words with us. You're more than welcome to stay and watch through Zoom, or you're more than welcome to watch through YouTube, however suits you. We'll take another quick break from speeches to share some more art and share some more music. You'll be seeing artwork from Farzana Yousefzai, who is just a beautiful person inside and out and a talented artist, as well as a recorded performance from Olcay Bayo, who I'm personally a huge fan of, and I saw her perform live in 2016 and she was phenomenal. So as soon as I get my share screen working again, I can put that up for you.
Hi, my name is Olcay Bayo. I'm a singer and a songwriter, live in London. I am from Turkey, of Kurdish origin. I'd like to thank Middle Eastern Women's Society for inviting me for this event, and that I am meeting you, and I will be singing for you. My music turned its face to my heritages, my background, the melodies or traditional melodies, the stories from the place that I came from. I grew up the region of Mesopotamia and Anatolia. I sing different languages spoken within the region, and I arrange traditional tunes, as well as I write my words and my music, I compose. I have two recorded albums I released in Europe and in the world as well. You may find them in Amazon, in Spotify, if you like to listen. Today I will be singing for you two songs. One of them will be an Armenian folk song called Merdan, a peasantry song, and it explains the life of peasantry. And the second one will be a Kurdish tune, one of my composition. It's called Havare. It means yelling. It's a woman's yelling on a wounded husband. A woman who lost her husband, and she expressing her deep grief in this song, and quite an emotional one. Yes, as we're going all through it, very difficult times, and we do things differently. I really hope that we go back to normal and make music, make art as we used to do, where we share it face to face and feel each other by feeling each other. And I really hope that we go back to normal really soon. But I'd like you to enjoy your event. And once again, thank you very much, Middle Eastern Women's Society, for inviting me. And I really hope to see you soon. And if you'd like to check me on social media, I'm on Instagram, Facebook, Spotify. You can check me out. And be well, stay safe, and enjoy your day. Hope to see you soon. Bye bye. Mm-hmm.
بر بیمن بینندگان عزیز، فرزان میرسفی هستم. بیش از 15 ساله که کار هنری رو انجام میدم. در سالهای قبل کارهایی رو با سیاه قلم با روزنامه انجام دادم و تعداد کارهایی هستش که با متریالی که به خودم در ایران به ثبت رسوندم که شامل چندین نخها که با زردی تخم مرده شده که الان دو نمونه اون رو داریم انجام میدیم. این اولین تابلوی بود که من وارد لندن شدن رو تونستم انجام بدم. این کار نقاشی برجسته است و این فریم هم که با همون کار متریال خودم پس انجام دادم. این یکی کار آناتومی یک خانومه که روی چوب انجام شده و با همین متریال چندین کاری گردنبند رو من انجام دادم که الان حدود بیش از 12-13 سالم هست که کارهای گردنبند رو انجام میدم. این نمونه ای از کاری گردنبند. به غیر از کاری که من انجام میدم، کاری متریال بهش میگیم نقاشی برجسته، که روی بوم و روی چوب بوده حالا چند نمونه کاره اول پینتینگ رو میخوام به شما نشون بدم. این تابلویی که شما میبینین آقا صفاست. این آقا صفای ما باغبان منزل مادرم بودن و چون همیشه یه چهره داشتن، چهره اون تنهایی و اون حس بی کسی رو، من این عکس رو که گرفتم داخل منزل بود و سعی کردم اینو از منزل بیارم بیرون که یه تصویر رو بکشم که به این حال و هوای این آقا صفای ما بیاد و چون عاشق سیگار بود من ترجیح دادم سیگاریشونم رو بکشم. این تصویر تصویر یک آقاست، یک آقای ایرانی، یک مرد روستا. من سعی کردم اون عمق نگاه، تردید، پیری و سردرگمی رو تو عمق چشاشون من نشون بدم. این تابلو رو که میبینیم تابلوی پیرمردی که تصور ذهنی من بود تو منطقه یهودی که زندگی میکردم. یهودی های زیادی رو میبینم میرفتن میمادن، ولی این تصویر کاملا تخیلیه و من این تصویر تنها چیزی رو که میبینم عشق و پاکی انسانیت از عمق نگاه این پیرمرد رو حس میکنم. و این تابلو تابلوی کابوس شبان است که هر شب این استراب و نگرانی بهش دست میده با یکی از دوستاش که مملو از آرامش و زیباییه با این صحبت میکنه. حالا چند نمونه از کار آبسترکت من انجام میدم که با پیگمنت انجام میدم. این تابلو تابلوی هست به نام انسان حیوان نما. این ادغام کرد، این تلفیقی بین رنگ روغن و آبسترکت. این به نام بانوی زیبای خفته یا زن زیبای خفته که در کرمانشاه هست، یک کوه به نام این و من سعی کردم این کوه که دقیقا حالتی از یک زن زیبای خفته است رو اینو نشون بدم. این تابلو تابلوی تفکره، تفکر از درد، تفکر از رنج و اینقدر این فکر میکنه که مغزمون بزرگتر از مغز آدم معمولی و از درد و رنج صورت اون هزاران هزار تیکه تبدیل شده از فکر زیاد. این تابلو تابلوی ترسه، ترس رو تو عمق چشمش میبینیم، ترس، وحشت یا حالت این که بهش بگیم دیوانگی. این تابلو به نام هاواره، به زبان کردی که به فارسی میشه فریاد، فریاد از مردم، فریاد. و این آخرین تابلو رو ما میگیم به نام تابلوی زن. که استوار شده بر مردم، قدرت. خب دوستان عزیز، ممنونم از این که منو دعوت کردین، ممنونم از این که وقتتون رو در اختیار من گذاشتین و ممنونم از این که این برنامه رو با صبر و حوصله دیدین. ممنونم، خدا نگهدار.
Brilliant. I love, love, love her art. It's, and the way she talks about it is so touching. And of course, Olcay's voice is phenomenal. I was dancing for myself, like in the second song especially. It was so beautiful. So welcome back to our YouTube live viewers. Now MEWSo would like to share two pre-recorded testimonies from our lovely clients Atefa Bahrambegi and Mulak Vakili. I've enjoyed working with them personally over the short 8 months that I've been at MEWSo, so I'm delighted to share their words with you today.
Good afternoon, dear ladies and friends. My name is Atefa Bahrambegi and I am an Iranian woman living in London. First, I want to tell you how I attended this group. Before three years ago, I was introduced to the Middle Eastern Women and Society organization by a friend. First, I was interested in advice services and I found some welfare advisors in this organization to bring up my issues. Gradually, I met another woman from my country, even another nations. So it was more and more interesting when I became more familiar with this group. I started to participate in workshops, meetings, or question and answer with solicitors, advisors, and advocacy professionals. Over time, I accompanied the group on inner city trips. It was so interesting for me because I had a chance to watch all around London where I have not been before. But little by little, I became a part of this group and I started to lead a workshop by myself. As a dentist, I had three times workshops about dental and oral hygiene. Once I had a workshop in quarantine about the tooth pain control at home during lockdown. I am professional in photography as well, and I'm preparing training programs in this field. On the other hand, I am a carer as well. Before that, I was joined this group. I was feeling so isolated and had no idea how to find friends in London. But now, after 5 non-stop living in London, I'm very satisfied in this city that I have so many friends, so many women from different nationality, from different cultures. And this gives me a self-confidence to manage my day-to-day life. And because of this situation, I'm really proud of being in this group and I'm ready to fight for women rights together with all women. Even after quarantine, the group activities didn't stop. It's so interesting. And we could gather more women to participate in Zoom meeting. For me personally, I attended mindfulness, Zumba class, or art and craft sessions. And when we are at home, we can still work together. It's so nice. Even those who have had no chance to come to the organization place, they can now attend the sessions in Zoom meeting. So it's so interesting, and we are trying to become active by ourselves and all family to involve all our family. So at the end, I really want to thank all those who are involved in this group, and they encourage us to fight for our rights, even for our daily life, and help us as a woman to understand our rights and be better and more aware of our living days. I wish to good luck to all your people, women especially, and I hope see you after quarantine face to face. Have a nice day.
Hello, lady and gentlemen. My name is Muluk Vakili. My art's name is Ala. I am an art teacher, and in my country I was researching about traditional clothes and culture since 3,000 years ago until now. When I came to the UK after a few times, I had very bad problem and I was not well. In the beginning, 2013, I found Middle Eastern Women's and Organization Society. When I went them and they knows about me, I spoke about myself, they helped me a lot for everything. Anything I need, they helped me, and I was very happy. After a few times when they saw me and they helped me, they understand about me, and they said, you can do something. And after a few years, I was very better, and I find myself. I do something for them. I am voluntary working for them. Anything I need, they help me. And another lady, client for them, like the first time like me, they need help. For anything I can do, I help them. Because I know about them the first time when I was unhappy, I would like everybody help me and to change my life. But now, anyone they have a problem, I know about them because I did everything in my life. But I did for them sometime for like facilitator cooking section or jewelry section. And for anything I can do, I help them for MEWSo. And about, I think, 2 and 3 years ago, for a few times, I did for them fashion show by MEWSo. I did for a lot of lady, for a lot of different culture, different country. I did for them fashion show about traditional clothes and about modern. The traditional clothes about Iran, Turkey, Syria, Iraq, and all my fashion show for traditional clothes, they have a background and they have some biography. And when I did fashion show, I told them about a biography in behind the my traditional clothes. Now I am very happy because I have them, and they are happy because they have me for help another lady. I wish this organization for future go bigger and bigger for help a lot of people, because a lot of lady and a lot of people need help. They help them very friendly and very they are very lovely ladies. They are working there. I hope everyone okay, and I wish you a world full of peace and health. I hope see you in the future. Everybody is very happy, and I am happy too, because when I saw people happy, I am happy. Thank you so much for everything, and my little speech is not good. I'm sorry, because this is not my first language. This is my third language. Thank you so much. Bye.
Oh, so sweet. just trying to get my bearings. Right. Well, those were our final client testimonies today. Now I would like to introduce you to MEWSo's senior domestic violence advisor, Zahra Habri, who has been with us for 7 years and whose dedication, passion, and commitment is an absolute inspiration to us all. She will now share a few words with us today. So I will spotlight it on you, Zahra, and take it away.
Hi, everyone. First of all, I would like to congratulate MEWSo on her 10th anniversary and not forgetting about the testimonies of my clients and other clients. I can't deny that it brought tears to my eyes. It's really touching. I mean, I can't describe how proud I feel about them, because it's not just my work, it's their achievement and being strong and standing for themselves. So some of them, they needed just a little push. Some of them needed just a little advice, but I was, you know, there to help them. I mean, experiencing domestic violence in the past myself has taught me a lot. And coming out of it, I promised myself that I would do my best to help others to come out of it, because so many of them used to come to me and think that there is no way of breaking the cycle of abuse. But I can tell you, this is not true. You can come out of it as I came out of it. And as I said, it's not because of my work, it's because of their strength and their commitment and the understanding of the situation as well. Before even discovering MEWSo, I used to help women. I used to help my neighbors and my friends in different situations. But calling services was just like as a friend or as a neighbor, and they wouldn't take me seriously. I mean, I was not getting the respect that I should get, you know, especially speaking on behalf of, you know, of others. But when I'm, you know, discovered MEWSo and Halaleh, it gave me a voice, because when I call on behalf of Middle Eastern Women in Society organization. I am an advisor and now I am a senior advisor. You have to listen. It is serious. These women need help and you need to listen to them. It's not a joke. We're not joking. It's very serious. It's not like just, you know, calling, oh, my friend is experiencing domestic violence. It's not as serious as an organization. So I'm so proud to be part of it. And I'm willing to learn more and more and have more knowledge about legislations, about trainings, and it's never enough for me. I'm like a sponge. I want to suck everything, all knowledge around the world to help, everything to help my women to overcome their situations and for the children as well to have a happy life. Because when a mother is happy, the world is happy around the children. If the mother is miserable and sad, children will be miserable and sad, and the whole society will be destroyed because of that. So we are helping and we will help and we will be always, you know, here to, you know, help our women. So what I want to say to my women over the world, there is always help. Especially here in England and the UK, there is resources tailored to help you. We are here as MEWSo. You can contact us anytime. We will help you. We will support you. You will find a way. And there is always a door. And the door that I want to talk to you about is that we have workshops. We have Zumba. We have mindfulness. We have art. So accessing to this services can help you in the future if you are in trouble. And that's always my window for all women. I know that sometimes perpetrators can, you know, follow you and say, but because there is activities, there is always a little window for you to ask for help. And finally, I thank everyone, the speakers, volunteers, my team, Halaleh. I thank you for coming, and I hope to see you soon. Thank you very much, Rob.
Thank you so much for your passionate speech. Next, I would like to invite Ellie, as we're drawing our event to a close, I would like, Ellie Angus is our fundraising manager who helped us create our 10-year anniversary report specifically for this event. So it would be wonderful for her to share, to just to see us out of this event with the all the achievements that we have done over the last 10 years. So Ellie, over to you.
Wow, what an amazing organization this is, isn't it? Not many people, I tell you, have the guts to address these sensitive issues in the same effective way as Halaleh and the team do. By now, you must have a good feeling of who we are, but allow me to recap in a very quick way and run through some of the most important points from our last 10 years. Can I ask Rose to make me co-host so I can share the screen? Yes. Oh, one participant can share the time.
Hold on.
Or you have the report as well. If you want, you can.
No. Hold on. Because I'm not sharing a screen at the moment. Let me take away. Try now.
Okay, now it's good. Okay. So we bring women in similar situations together to support each other. We bring a society where every woman lives in a safe way with equal rights and equal opportunities. Our mission is to support and empower women to rebuild their lives and promote equality, integration, and community cohesion. And we are guided by several principles. This is the principle of solidarity, secularism, social justice, collaboration, and last but not least, equality and diversity. And as it's our 10th anniversary, I've prepared 10K activities that we are either running or have run in the past and will try to reinstall in future. So we offer one-to-one advice on welfare and domestic violence by appointments over the phone or online most frequently because of the COVID situation nowadays. We also partner with solicitor firms to provide qualified advice for women on immigration status, asylum, sexual violence, divorce, relationship breakdown, and more. We provide training and organized awareness events for women and community organizations on domestic violence, polygamy, virginity testing, hymenoplasty, and LGBTQ+ rights, among others. We gather at community venues for workshops and classes, or to share recipes and prepare tasty and healthy lunches and celebrate diversity and community spirit. We offer one-to-one English language support for isolated women through our team of qualified volunteer teachers. We gather for coffee and cake, quizzes, and thematic walks to explore and learn new amazing facts about our neighborhoods. Of course, we provide mindfulness, breathwork, and meditation classes. And we understand that for some women, talking about their issues is too difficult. So we offer art therapy classes as a way to self-express and process feelings, as well as a way to create new hobbies. We recognize the importance of physical exercise and run weekly dance or Zumba or Pilates classes. And our dedicated volunteer befrienders provide weekly one-to-one encouragement to help isolated women stay connected with their community and support each other. And now let me take you through a quick trip back in time so you can see where we were and where we stand now. In 2010, Halaleh, she was a social worker at the time, and felt the need to address the social isolation that the woman she supported faced. And that's how in the summer of 2010, MEWSo was born, to offer befriending to women once their immediate needs of shelter and welfare support were met. In 2011, we rented our first office space in Durham Road Resource Center. A structural poverty was a recurring issue for the women we supported. In 2012, we expanded our services to provide welfare and benefits advice services. Domestic violence, isolation, poverty, all these affect our emotional well-being and self-esteem. And therefore, we piloted counseling and mental health support for women survivors of domestic abuse. Then in 2014, we looked at ways to improve the health and physical well-being of the women we supported. We introduced Pilates, swimming, fitness and gardening classes, organized workshops on healthy eating and new ways of cooking traditional meals in a more healthier way. As we noticed that many participants did not feel ready to access mainstream ESO classes or even attend job interviews because of their level of English, we piloted one-to-one English teaching method, something similar to our befriending method. We have supported many women since now to build up self-confidence, knowledge and the skills so they can improve their life situation by getting into education or getting a job. In 2016, we expanded our support to women experiencing domestic abuse and gender-based violence, and this was especially following the migrant crisis, when we were accommodating increased number of refugee women and who came to this country, and our welfare and benefits, and our domestic violence advisor, she supported many of them to settle well in the UK. MEWSo's collaboration with Greenwich University and Polygamy became in 2017 with a series of creative workshops. Our Polygamy Matters campaign nowadays aims to raise awareness on women's and children's rights and the consequences of entering polygamous relationships. It aims also to develop prevention and support services, educate about harmful customs and practices. And we also want to gain attention of the government so the existing legislations are enforced. 2018, this year we joined Step Up Migrants. It's a coalition of 40 organizations campaigning to put women's human rights over and above immigration status. MEWSo wants for all women with unsettled migration status suffering abuse or domestic violence to be able to report their abuses to the police without fear of being detained, deported, made destitute, or maybe losing custody of their children. Going to 2019 now, we strengthened our support for women from the LGBTQ plus spectrum by piloting various activities to build their confidence and resilience, as well as reinforce feelings of being valued and accepted, and of course, create connections and lasting support network. And in the longer term, our campaign aims to develop, challenge and possibly change the attitudes of our community to accept and tolerate others' choices regarding their sexuality and gender by raising awareness on LGBTQ plus issues. And actually, we also want to provide educational seminars and classes for the adults in the community. And now, we started this year with Halaleh giving several interviews on the importance of recognizing forced virginity testing, and that this is an existing issue in our communities. And this is the year we want to focus actually our efforts on vocalizing the traumas, the needs and the experience of all those women who have their human rights violated. With our campaign on banning virginity testing, we want to provide prevention and support services, raise awareness about women's and children's rights, enforce a law to ban virginity testing, and make sexual education mandatory part of the school curriculum in order to eradicate some archaic notions of virginity for the future generations. We have existed for 10 years now, and we hope to exist for many more times then. And here are our pledges for the next 10 years. We want to empower women to live independent lives and make their own decisions. We want to support women integrate and feel included into the society. We want to challenge the cultural beliefs that equate a woman's worth to her virginity. And of course, we will work in partnership with other community organizations in order to maximize the positive impact for the women we support. We want to work towards improving the welfare and housing system for women, because this will ensure that they are in a safe space and safe from their perpetrators. Of course, we will continue to promote healthy attitudes towards eating and exercising among women from our communities. We also want to guarantee the fundamental rights of safety and security to all women with unsettled immigration status who are trapped in domestic abuse. We also want to educate communities about the harmful consequences of entering polygamous relationships. We will challenge harmful attitudes towards women from of different sexual orientation and gender identities, and we will try to tackle sexual discrimination in all ways possible. And last but not least, we will advocate for mental health awareness among our communities and support our participants to look after their emotional well-being and mental health. So thank you very much. At the end of my presentation, I just want to share with you all that I can feel overpowering love and support, and I'm so proud to be part of this amazing organization. Thank you all for joining today, and have a lovely rest of our celebration.
Thank you so much, Ellie, for a wonderful PowerPoint presentation. It's so nice to see everything that MEWSo has done in such a beautiful way. So thank you so much. Before, I'm looking at the time now, we still have a bit of time before our 6 p.m. close. Before we say our goodbyes and hear some words from Halaleh and say our thank yous to all the wonderful people who are watching us on YouTube Live right now, I have been given another clip from a music clip from a lady from our community called Somaye. And she is a musician from our community, and her work combines mostly Middle Eastern rhythms accompanying Western songs. So I will play this for you, and then we'll come back and wrap it up and say our goodbyes. Thank you.
I'm going to perform a song for you by Feroze. This is called Le Beirut. Thank you. Okay, this next song I'm going to play is called Fever by Peggy Lee. And for the Iranians amongst you, Ino Besh Migim Baba Karame Ingilisi. fever. When you kiss them, fever. If you live, you learn. Fever. Till you sizzle. What a lovely way to burn. What a lovely way to burn. What a lovely way to burn.
Brilliant. Great. So that brings us to a close for today. Halaleh, would you like to say a few words before we can wrap it up?
Well, actually, I would say that that was amazing. And it was one of the proof in virtual life that we are going now that non-corona, nothing can stop us to work, to celebrate together, to share together, to continue what we promised people. We celebrated the first 10 years, even we had it such hard times sometimes, but we came to a day that we showed everyone, and people by their speech, people by their testimony showed us as well, that how much our work was important, and they appreciated, and it gave us a lot encouragement and power and feeling good about ourselves to continue more. From tomorrow we are starting again working. From tomorrow women are coming crying on our shoulder, but we make them smile when they are going out. From tomorrow again we are challenging many issues in the society by our campaign. From tomorrow, maybe some people call us troublemaker, but many women, many men, many children, many young girls are proud of us. They see us as a people that exactly they are looking for that talk, that get help, and stand up on their feet. And that's the best things that happening with our organization. I thank you so much again, our founders today, that today was here, and those who couldn't come, our network, our campaign workers in other organization, all friends around us, those organizations who always we are in touch by telephone, and refer to each other, and we are talking about the clients, we are talking about the situation, how much is hard for this woman, and we must help her as soon as possible. And all those volunteers and staff team, wonderful team, that thank you so much. It was a huge pleasure for me after 10 years. It looks like that I think tonight I will sleep very well because of all the happiness that I see here in these 3 hours. And thank you so much for all you asset, for all your work, for everything that we are doing together. Thank you so much for audience that starting knowing us. Some of them know us, some of them maybe it will be new for them. Be in touch with us, stay with us, help us, and refer any women, your neighbor, anyone who needs help. Just stay in touch with us and look after yourself. Take care in this corona situation. We all promise each other that to be stronger after this corona situation. Have a good evening, everybody. Thank you so much, Rose and the team and all people behind this scene, all the stuff that work with the translation, with the films, with the report, and many more people. Thank you so much. Have a lovely evening.
Thank you, Halaleh. Yep, so that's us drawing to a close. I just want to say thank you to our wonderful speakers who took time out of their schedules to share their words with us. Thank you to our fantastic and brave clients who are watching on YouTube Live, who shared their testimonies with us. Thank you so much. Thank you to the musicians and the artists who participated. I would like to thank Halaleh most importantly for her vision and passion and drive for creating MEWSo 10 years ago. And of course, I would also like to thank my amazing team for all their hard work, for the women who work behind the scenes in creating this event today. Thank you for joining us. And on behalf of MEWSo, we wish you a happy and safe weekend ahead. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.